If you have your Bibles with you, I'd ask you to turn to the book of Genesis. Genesis chapter 22, and I will begin reading in the very first verse, Genesis 22. In the first verse, the Bible says, "And it came to pass after these things that God did tempt Abraham and said unto him, Abraham? And he said, Behold, here am I. And he said, Take now thy son, thy only son, Isaac, whom thou lovest, and get thee into the land of Moriah, and offer him there for a burnt offering upon the mountains which I will tell thee of. And Abraham rose up early in the morning and saddled his ass, and took two of his young men with him, and Isaac his son, and clave the wood for the burnt offering, and rose up and went into the place which God had told him. Then on the third day Abraham lifted up his eyes and saw the place afar off. And Abraham said unto his young men, Abide ye here with the ass, and I and the lad will go yonder and worship and come again to you." I'd like to preach, the Lord be my helper tonight, on the thought, I want to go over yonder. Dear Lord, we thank you for your goodness, your watch care. Lord, we thank you for the blessings that you provide this church. Lord, we pray tonight that you'd simply meet with us. Lord, we stand in need of most of you filling the house here with your presence. Lord, it would be good if the word was just read, and if you would meet with us, that would be enough. Lord, we pray for the lost that meet with us, God, that you would give them a pull from on high, that they might understand and know that their condition is dreadful before you. Lord, speak to their heart and save them. According to your mercy and grace, Lord, we pray now that you would bless your word, that you would fill men's hearts with it, and we'd be faithful to give you the praise for it. For it is in Christ's name we do pray. Amen. Now, very familiar verses of Scripture, but I guess, neglected one thing in reading many times before, in the fact that he says, I and the lad will go yonder. Now, you used to hear a lot of people say, go over yonder, and it is a real word. I think most people would think it was a hick word and it didn't exist, but going yonder is a real thing. Now, yonder, according to the dictionary that I can find, it's a place far away. It is not a nearness. It's something that takes you a bit of time to get to. It's not next door. It is further from you than the average place. That is to go yonder. And a lot of people will say, well, I'll just go over yonder. Well, that is not really going yonder. That is going next door. Going yonder involves travel time. Going yonder takes some initiative, and that's what Abraham planned to do. Back in the first verse, and it says, and it came to pass after these things. Now, the things that had happened was this in a nutshell. Hagar and Ishmael were cast out, and they were done with, and God had met with Abraham and with Abram and changed his name to Abraham, and the covenant now was full. It was all done. Things were good to go. Now, I'll say that if you want to go yonder, you're going to have to cast sin aside. Hagar and Ishmael, what they represent is sin. Right. What they represent is things that will hinder, that will bring you down, that will cause you to have attachment with this world. And he had set that aside, and you think that would be shouting ground. You think that would be a time to rejoice. But I want you to see, when you get in a condition that's good before God, one of two things will happen. God will try you, or the devil will hinder you, and it's always that way. Right. And so we see in this case, the one that brought forth the trial was God himself. Now, most of the time when we get in to problems, we immediately blame the devil. But I want you to see, many times the trials are begotten of God, and even when they do come by way of the devil, it's under God's jurisdiction. And so that is the sovereign God of the Bible. And so we see that this had to be effectual in Abraham's life, or it wouldn't have happened. And then it says, and he said unto him, Abraham, and he said, Behold, here I am. Now that's a mouthful in of itself, and most of the time, even if we say it, we don't mean it.
Right.
Here am I. Now that's yielding yourself. In Isaiah chapter 6, Isaiah says of himself, remember, God had come down and filled the veil, the temple with the veil, and it left Abraham in a condition that he said, here I am, send me, send me. That is time spent with God. Now today, most people really don't experience that. They don't have a time like this when they're so close to God that he gives them a trial in his life. And that's what was happening to Abraham. Verse 2, he says, take now thy son, thine only son Isaac, whom thou lovest, and get thee unto the land of Moriah, and offer him there for a burnt offering upon one of the mountains which I will tell thee of. Now, a couple of things about this command. The first one, I want you to see that God only recognized Isaac as a son. He never recognized Ishmael. He never recognized the six that he had by Keturah. He only recognized Isaac. Even though others existed, he recognized Isaac. You know why? Because he was the chosen one. That's the type of election. Is that he was the only one to be recognized. Now, and also he gives him a very grisly command. Now, we all know the story, and we all rejoice at the end, but could you imagine how grisly it would be for him to say, go kill your son, go take his life, go cut him apart on Mount Moriah, you get the job done. Now, the biggest thing that would stand in the way is this flesh. Because you remember what a miracle child Isaac was. And how badly Abraham wanted an inheritor. And he said, okay, I'm going to take him from you. No promises. No, he'll be okay at the end. Nothing. You give his life. Now, I say that to say this. We ought to be ready and willing to give our lives. We need to give them in the years of our youth. And we need to even be willing to give them our head on the chopping block. And you say, well, that's crazy. Listen, it's coming. The government is on a downhill run. And people like us are going to be viewed with all speculation. And all, you say, oh, that will never happen. Well, tell Germany in the 1930s that it will never happen. Listen, it happened and it will happen again. But this time on our country's soil. And so we see that he asked an unbelievable thing of Abraham. And that says to me, listen, he might ask an unbelievable thing of you. He may ask you to go above and beyond. He may ask you to say, oh, I'm not able. Now remember, this is the man that was promised a son at 100 years old. Is there anything God can't do? Is there anything he can't do? These people go on the mission field in their late 70s, in their 80s. Yes, they do if God's in it. And if they're a mind to serve God. And that was his situation here. Now, I want you to also see, he says, I want you to go to the top of one of the mountains that I will show thee. Now, remember at this time, Abraham is probably somewhere around 110 years old. The exact age of Isaac at the time of the proposed sacrifice is uncertain, but he was somewhere between 110 and 120 years old. And he says, I want you to climb a mountain. Now, I had my first mountain climbing experience a few months ago, and at first advice I'll give you, don't wait till you're in your late 40s for your first mountain climbing experience. It's not as easy as it looks. And he says, I want you to take this boy that you've waited 100 years for, and I want you as a 110-year-old man to climb the mountain, get to the top, and offer him for a sacrifice. That was God's plan. That's what he wanted him to do. You know, the very best thing you can do with your own hopes and dreams is sacrifice them before God. That's the very best. That was his hopes and dreams. Everything depended on Isaac. And he says, I want you to offer him there. I want you to spill his blood. I want you to make the atonement with him. Verse 3, and Abraham rose up early in the morning. Now, had that been the average person, we would have slept around. We probably would have approached it with prayer again, and we would have had a dismal attitude about it. But I want you to see that he woke up and he was ready to go. He got up with the sun, he got everything together, and he was on the road. Sometimes when Brother Ashley and I go on preaching times, I mean, he is always here before me, and he's always bright-eyed and ready to go, and I mean, he's got that morning thing down. You know what Abraham did, too? He was ready to go. Yeah. He didn't have the hubby-drubbies. He wasn't with the old me's. He was sitting on ready. Now, if you want to serve the Lord, and you want to get to the place that's yonder, you're not going to do it with everyday service. You're not going to do it with the routine. You're going to do it with exemplary service, and you're going to do it only when you're ready to move. You know what's wrong with the Lord's people today? We're not ready to move. And I don't mean missionary-wise. So I would say that's part of it. But we're not really ready to move out of our comfort zone. We've got a little path we like to direct ourselves in, and the holy blessing of God may be that far over, and we're too tie in this to go over there yonder. And so I want you to see that Abraham did not have that problem. He was ready to go. He was up. He had a very unbelievable task to do that day. But he got up. He got everything together. And he was ready. He was ready to roll when the sun came up. And Abraham rose up early in the morning and saddled his ass and took two of his young men with him, and Isaac his son, and clave the wood of the burnt offering, and rose up and went into the place of which God had told him. Now, I want you to see another thing that Abraham did is to get where God told him to be. Now, where that's at for you, that's where you need to be. If it's on a pew somewhere, that's where you need to be. If it's on the backside of the desert somewhere, that's where you need to be. If it's just a word of encouragement to somebody that you're with, that's where you need to be. So for this moment and this time, Abraham's spot was placed by God in between these mountains, in this place where they took camp. Then on the third day, now I also want you to see, to get over yonder takes patience. Now, we may spy something out here like at the end of the cemetery and say, oh, that's where I need to be. Well, what we need to do is just simply wait on the Lord. We just need to give him time. Now, you remember all this time from the day that he said it to the next day that they took out, and we really don't know how long it took them to get there. And now they abided 3 days once they got there looking for the mountain. Which one do you want him on? Which place can I go? And you know what? He didn't get impatient. He was waiting to say, go yonder. He was waiting on the Lord God to say, this is where I want you. This is the spot I need you. And he patiently waited on the Lord. You know, we need that desperately today. And just wait on our Lord and wait till he gives us the place and the time that he would have us serve him. Verse 5, and Abraham said unto the young men, abide ye here with the ass, and I and the lad will go yonder and worship and come again to you. Now I want you to see, now that he saw the place, he was ready to go yonder. Now, my own idea is this, and it's about worth as much as any other of my ideas, but we do know that they were in this spot, and the place of the sacrifice was in one of the mountains, says verse 2. And they had a mountain to climb, and it was over yonder. It was a piece off. It wasn't an easy journey. 110-year-old man, 115, and 10 or 12-year-old boy going up the mountain together. But that's where God wanted them. I'm going to go for Yonder. I'm going to go the distance. Now, if anything is the problem today, it's a lack of people in interest of going the distance for the Lord. They want everything right here and easy seasy. But when it comes down to serving the Lord and going a little bit of extra distance, then they're not ready to do it that much anymore. And so we find that Abraham was in a mind to go a little further. He was in a mind to go the distance for the Lord. He was in the mind to do whatever was necessary to be done. Verse 6, and Abraham took the wood of the burnt offering and laid it upon Isaac his son, and he took the fire in his hand and a knife, and they went both of them together. And Isaac spake unto Abraham his father and said, My father? And he said, Here am I, my son. And he said, Behold, the fire and the wood, but where is the lamb for a burnt offering? And Abraham said, My son, God will provide himself a lamb for a burnt offering. So they went both of them together. Now, I want you to see that there's never any disobedience in this. Now, you know the rest of the chapter, especially verses 9 and 10, that says that Abraham set everything in order, that he put Isaac on the altar, and he drew back the knife. Now, I don't know how many of you have ever seen a 110-year-old person, but I've seen one. When I was a boy, I was about 17, and in the nursing home down in Erin, I saw a man that was 110. That was in the early 80s, 86. He'd born in 1876. And he was the son of freed slaves. And they're feeble. Everybody called him Pappy. Now, he still had a clear mind, but he was very infirmed by age. He couldn't walk anymore. He had to be fed. His vision was just about gone. So think about your 10-year-old or your 12-year-old or your 15-year-old. If Isaac wasn't willing, what would he have done? I mean, a 110-year-old person's a piece of cake. So there was a willingness there on Isaac's part, too. If this is God's plan, and Abraham says, I'll do it. And somewhere along the way, Isaac picked up the same attitude. If this is God's plan, we'll do it. We'll follow through. We'll go yonder. So I want you to see, if you want to be in that spot of yonder, it's going to take some things. You've got to align yourself with the Word of God. You've got to align your home with the Word of God. You've got to align your people with the Word of God and be focused on the things of God to go yonder. It's a distance beyond the average. It's a distance that takes a little further to go. It's a distance that may be all uphill, but it's worth it once you get there. And oh, what a blessed thing it was whenever they found the ram in the bush. When God says, I've seen you do it. I've seen you faithful. And now I'll give you a ram. He provided the ram. But he had to go yonder. You know, the very reason we have this is because Abraham did it. He went yonder and he told for the next generations, this is what I've done. You know, can you imagine Isaac saying to his children, you know what? One time we went up on the mountain and Dad put his knife out on me and we knew that was going to be it, and God intervened. See, those kind of stories go on down the hill, don't they? They go from generation to generation according to the Word of God. And so we see then that this individual, they went over yonder. They went outside the norm. They were interested in a different way. Look with me in the book of Numbers. Numbers 23. Numbers 23, we'll begin reading in verse 11. We have a story of a prophet and a ruler, a preacher, and a individual that ruled the land. Verse 11 says, And Balak said unto Balaam, What hast thou done unto me? I took thee to curse mine enemies, and behold, thou hast blessed them all together. Now, Balak was a politician. He was a man that liked to control things. He was a man that liked to be in charge. And he got a preacher, and he thought he had bought him a preacher. That he got it where the preacher would say just what he wanted them to say. You know, that is the trouble with the world today. It's too many preachers are doing exactly what the world has to offer and go along just with whatever agenda the church has chosen. And what they really need is a pastor. What they really need is a leader saying, this is what the Word of God says. Not to be a bully about it, but just leading them through the Word of God. That's what a pastor is to do. And so I want you to see Balak had a little different individual in Balaam. Balaam was faithful to the Word of God. Balaam continued in the Word of God. And this is what his desire was. Verse 12. And he answered and said, Must I not take heed to speak that which the Lord hath put in my mouth? Now, any kind of preacher that's worth his salt, that will be what he tells you. It may sound pleasant at times, like I'm going home to be with Jesus. And it may be a little more difficult at other times, come out from among them and be separate. It may be easy sometimes. Talking about the 12 gates of the city. And other times it might be a little difficult when you're talking about the very hottest part of hell. But we need it all. And so Balaam says, have I not been faithful? I must preach what the Lord has given to me. I must preach as He gives it to me. Verse 13, and Balaam said unto him, come, I pray thee, with me unto another place, from whence thou mayest see them. And thou shalt see but the utmost part of them, and shall not see them all, and curse me from thence. And he, meaning Balak, brought him, meaning Balaam, into the field of Zophim, to the top of Pisgah, and built 7 altars, and offered a bullock and a ram on every altar. Now, I want you to see the individual that's offering this great sacrifice was trying to impress Balaam. He was trying to say, oh, look what I've done. Look at the things we've accomplished. Look how much I love the Lord. And laying all that out before him, saying, look, I'm killing 7. We built up 7 altars. I'm putting an altar on each one. What he really wanted was him to say exactly what he wanted him to say. And he says, this is the way I'll get it done. You know, if I do enough, the preacher is going to do what I would like him to do. And so we see that as well. Now read with me in verse 12. And Balaam said unto Balak, verse 12. Verse 14, and he brought him unto the field of Zophim, to the top of Pisgah, and built 7 altars, and offered a bullock and a ram on every altar. And he said unto Balak, stand here by the burnt offering, while I meet with the Lord yonder. Now, I read that to say this, they had all this religion going on at this one place with the 7 altars and the 7 lambs. And he says, where I need to be is over yonder. Where I need to be is a place by myself with the Lord. Where I need to be is not at this spot where all this religion is going on, but I need to go over yonder and speak with the Lord. You know, many times we need to get out of the routine and just go speak with the Lord. Just go have some prayer time with Him. Just go speak to Him as the Lord would have us to. And I believe a lot of times what we would have is a more close-knit relationship with the Lord if we would follow through with that and get away from the world, get away from whatever the hindrances may lie, get over yonder someplace. You know, to get over yonder, it has to be worth it to you. You know why we don't? It's simply not worth the effort in our eyes.
That's right.
Now, it is worth the effort. Don't get me wrong about that. but it's not worth the effort in our eyes. When all the children were at home, there just wasn't no free time. It just not. So me and Donna got a word or two at the end. At the end, it was at the end of the day. And sometimes we'd stay up 11 o'clock waiting all the kids to be asleep for maybe a 40-minute conversation. Now I'm conked out before we get to the 40-minute. But it was worth the wait. It was worth the wait, letting everything else set aside so we could evaluate how things were going with the children, how things were going with the home, what we were to do, what would be the best next decision. That is a time to be at home, to be alone with the Lord. And we had to get over some hurdles to get there. You know what? If you really are sincere about serving the Lord, there'll be hurdles in the way, and you need to go over yonder and put the things of this world aside for a little while and find the perfect will of God. Now, we should always be Christ-like. That's what the Bible commands us to do. That's why when they were first called Christians in Antioch, because it was a derogatory term. It did not mean any. It wasn't meant to be a compliment at any rate. But go read the Gospel of Matthew, and we'll find what the Lord Jesus did. He was willing to do this to find the very will of the Father. The Gospel of Matthew, chapter 26, verse 36. Matthew 26 and verse 36, the Bible says, "Then cometh Jesus with them unto a place called Gethsemane, and saith unto the disciples, Sit ye here while I go and pray yonder." Now, it's never really said how far this is. I think the Gospel of Luke, I think, says maybe a stone's throw. That there is another Gospel that gives you a little bit more idea of about how far it is. But he wasn't close to them. It was a further distance. Now, this Gospel tells us that the inner three went with him at least a portion of the way. And then he went out even a little further to speak to the Father. You know what? When you have a big problem come your way, the very best thing you can do is put it before the Lord. Right. To just, you know, spread out all the pieces and let Him take care of it. Let Him intervene. Let Him be the master of the plan. You know, we think that we have all the problems and that we can solve everything. It's an impossibility to solve everything. And so we need to simply rely upon the Lord. "Then cometh Jesus with them into a place called Gethsemane, and saith unto the disciples, Sit ye here while I go and pray yonder. And he took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, and began to be sorrowful and very heavy. And he saith unto them, My soul is exceeding sorrowful, even unto death. Tarry ye here and watch with me." So the Lord Jesus left the nine and went with the three, and then he left the three and went on even a little further. You know, some of the best times that we can have is by yourself, with yourself, with no hindrances of this world at all. You know what? If I was in a situation of seeking what the Lord would have me to do as an individual, that's the time I would spend. That's the things that I would do. Is get off somewhere by myself. Find out what the will of God is for me. And as a man, if you can find out what the will of God is for you, God will show you what the will of God is for your family. And that's certainly where we as the Lord's people need to be. And so then I want you to see the attitude of the others. Verse 39, "And he went a little further and fell on his face and prayed, says, Oh, my Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as thou wilt. And he saith unto the disciples, and findeth them asleep, and saith unto Peter, What, could you not watch with me 1 hour? Watch and pray that ye enter not into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. And he went away again the second time." And I want you to notice a couple of things in there. Very familiar verses of Scripture. But I want you to see that they came back and he said, What, you couldn't watch with me Now, the watch he was talking about is to protect him, to be things sure things were safe, because they were coming to get him. I also want you to think about being exceedingly sorrowful, it said that if it could be possible that it would pass from him. Now, I personally don't think that he was talking about the cup of death, because he said, I'm going to die. 3 days again, I will rise, right? But he had tasted a bitter cup, and that was sin. He'd never experienced sin before. He'd always been distanced from it. He'd watched sin all through the time that he'd been here, yet without sin. And now he's going to take upon himself my sin, your sin, all this sin of the elect onto himself. And he says, that's bitter. I wish I didn't have to drink of this. Yeah. I've never experienced sin. I don't like this. This is disgusting. But he was going to take it. And he asked it to be passed from him, but it was an impossibility. Had he not took of the cup, which was our sin, and been an atonement to us, it would have all been worth it. But I want you to see that out in that place, he and the three went one place, and he went on a little further by himself. It was out in that spot that he found the perfect will of God. And it was not only to die on the cross of Calvary, it was to take that sin cup for me. And I'm sure my portion of it was one of the most bitter. And I'm sure yours was not much better than mine. He said, I'll do it. And he did it. I believe this time is when the Father turned his back on him. He had to. Because he couldn't overcome sin. And so, we need to take a little time and go yonder. We need to learn how to break away, even in the longness of our day, and just spend some time with the Lord. And when you've got big decisions to make, go somewhere by yourself and pray it out. Don't do anything on the flip of a moment. Because any time I've ever done that later on, I'm sorry. And so we need to know the Lord. All right, work with me.